Welcome back to the Breaking Bread Podcast. Today we've got a special guest, someone who's been through a little bit of a journey lately. Someone who, again, has a story to tell. Someone who we can get on this podcast and be able to express himself and tell his story the way that he wants to tell it. And just give him this opportunity just to, basically tell his story. So before we get into it, we'll roll the intro. Welcome back. Again, like we said, we got a special guest on hand today. We got someone that, like we said, has been through a little bit of a journey lately. Someone who has a story to tell, and obviously we're giving him this platform for him to tell. So you want to welcome him on. And firstly, my name is Francis anyway.
Yeah, my name is Brody. And we'd like to welcome on Adrian Lole. Just give us a little intro into who you are and where you come from, a little bit about yourself as well.
Yeah, firstly, thank you for having me, boys. Glad to be here. Adrian Lole, Samoan, Kiwi born. Yes. Born and raised out east, out in Pakuranga.
Oh.
Yeah, 576.
Yeah.
My schooling out, Pakuranga Heights, Pakuranga Intermediate, and then made my way to Manawa Grammar.
Yeah.
Only grammar.
The real lion.
The real lion. Now, like you said, you grew up out east. Whereabouts are you residing now?
So currently in Blockhouse Bay, New Windsor.
BHB.
Yeah, BHB. The Bay.
The Bay.
The Bay.
Is it the only bay or what?
Only bay.
All good. We'll get into the questions.
Yeah, we'll get into our quick five questions for you. So, what's your go-to karaoke song?
Probably "Love Will Keep Us Alive," Eagles.
Ooh. Any demos?
Nah. That's sick.
All right. Who's the best rugby player you've ever played with?
Best? Probably Caleb Clark. Played with him at Max, yeah. Probably him.
Who's the grubbiest?
It was actually on your podcast, Woolly T. Grubbiest.
He is pretty grubby, eh?
Yeah.
A lot of people don't know, but if you watch him play and you know who he is, he's a bit of a grub.
Who's the funniest player you've ever played with?
Funniest? Not too sure. Probably Ash, Suburbs. Ash Tui, a good friend of mine. Ash. Pretty funny throughout the season, yeah.
Bit of a character, is he?
Yeah, a bit of a comedian.
Keeps the energy and vibes.
Keeps the morale up.
That's what we need.
Who's your rugby idol?
Someone I looked up to growing up, Ma'anonu. Yeah. In the midfield, always aspired to be like him. But
and who's your idol off the field, away from rugby?
Have to be Jesus, right? Look up to Jesus.
Nice. Obviously, you said you went to school out east. Pakuranga ways, and then you made your way back into Mags. Tell us a little bit about your time at Mags. What it was like for you.
Yeah.
How were you at school, and were you a good student?
Yeah, I was a good student. Mags was interesting. Bit of a weird journey for me. When I first started there, it didn't really fit in. At Mags, it was pretty overwhelming coming from out east, being one of the only ones I knew where I was from, coming to Mags. Played rugby there, up and down between second and first. I love school, not just going to eat my lunch, but I like being in the classroom as well. So, yeah.
Like you.
Were you a bit of a smart guy in class? Or?
I like to think so.
Yeah.
I was cheeky as well. So
yeah.
I was out of class sometimes.
Had a good mixy.
Yeah.
When you say you didn't fit in, what was it? Do you reckon that why you thought you didn't fit in when you first got there?
Yeah, it was hard because a lot of my mates stuck around schooling out east, because we moved house when I was year 9, yep. So we moved to Blockhouse Bay.
Yeah.
So I ended up staying with Chujon, cousin Chujon actually. Shout out Chujon.
Shout out Chujon.
So stayed with them, went to Mags, but I didn't really have a friend group.
Mm.
So I was a floater in school.
Yeah.
Yeah. I had a few good mates that I still keep in touch with now, but other than that, I floated around school a lot.
Mm. Yeah. Was rugby something you're always into, or was that something that when you got to Mags, was that something that you kind of like got into a bit more seriously, or? Tell us a little bit about your rugby journey at Mags.
Yeah, so growing up, my first sport was soccer. So football, I played football first, right up until under 12s. Then I went to rugby. So I guess it's kind of late in a sense. Didn't try for the rugby academy at school. Mm. I didn't really see the point in it. Mm. I tried hard in rugby at school. Obviously, didn't crack it the way I wanted to. Yep. Only had a few games up in first 15, but school's not everything.
Yeah,
so it was all good for me.
Just in regards, who's some of the players that you've played with at Mags that have gone on? Besides, you already mentioned Caleb.
Yeah, so Caleb was one, obviously. Noel Foster, playing for the Stags, Southland Stags.
Yep.
Yeah, he's a mean player, bro. He should have got a crack a while ago. And then the other boys, like Paulie Roach, they were a year above.
Oh, yeah.
But more of those boys than the year above me cracked it, I'd say.
Yeah.
Yeah, they went on.
Is that Ice in that as well?
Yeah, Ice as well.
Mm. Oh, mean.
Yeah. What's been, like, your greatest achievement on and off the field?
On the field, probably in terms of winning, probably second 15.
Mm.
Yeah, we I don't think we lost the game that season.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not a 1A or a first 15 or club, but yeah, that was a pretty good 1A.
Yeah.
Off the field, apart from my degree, probably having a beautiful girlfriend.
Yeah.
Especially the last, during my journey of injury and recovery, she's been a massive part of it. Eh? Mm. So yeah, probably that's a big achievement, I'd say, my girlfriend.
Yeah. But when you said about your degree, what did you get a degree in?
So I graduated with a Bachelor of Arts, majoring in Criminology and Psychology.
Hey.
Yeah.
Sure.
So you were really smart in the class.
I had a lot of help in my uni days, yeah. Lots of help, yeah.
Well, mean. You said that you've got a beautiful partner and she's been with you through your journey. Do you want to tell us a little bit about the journey that you've just sort of embarked on or like just gone through? Tell us what happened and how things have been going.
Yeah, so the game we had Ponsonby, No Easy Ponies. So yeah, we had them. We needed to win, and then so on the day, it was like the last 5 minutes of the game too. Mm. So I made it through like 90% of the game. And then I was caught in a ruck, but I didn't remember the ruck too clearly.
Yeah.
And then I got up. As I got up, there was a fight going on the sideline between some of the players. And then I start to go blurry. And then I just see a white light. But at the same time, my left foot gave way, but I shot up right up to my knee. So I couldn't feel anything below my knee.
Shit.
Yeah. And then, so I went down. Well, I was doing the stanky leg. Eh?
Mm.
Went down, got up, went down again, got up. And I signaled over to the physio to get me off.
Yeah.
I was like, get me off. So I could barely make it to the goal line. Lucky we were 5 meters out. And then once we hit the goal line, I pretty much sat down and then laid back because I couldn't handle it.
Yeah.
My head was like pounding so hard, I like wanted to come out of my brain wanted to come out of my head. Shit. Yeah, so and then I just told my physio, I need to lie back. My eyes rolled back and then I was out from there.
Damn, so you don't even remember anything from the ruck or anything? You didn't know it was a head injury or anything?
So I watched the game back when I was in the hospital.
Mm.
And I literally got up and like it felt like a brush. Like it didn't feel much of a knock. Mm. And that's why I was buzzing out, because it was delayed as well. Mm. It was like 30 seconds and then I start to go down. Yeah. It's crazy.
So your sort of last memory was sort of just laying back,
yeah,
closing your eyes,
just seeing
and then
a white light.
You wake up in hospital.
Yeah, so I woke up the next day, but I was still on sedation, so I was pretty knocked out.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you know what happened in between that time you went, when you were knocked out, to the hospital? Has anyone, like family or friends, partner, said anything about what happened during that time? Like, yeah, obviously there would have been an ambulance ride and all of that carry on. Can you explain to us what happened in between there?
It was pretty crazy, actually, the time from when I went down to, like, that whole weekend.
Mm.
So when I went down, so everyone thought I had done my hammy
because
I was lying down, but they soon realized what actually happened.
Mm.
Like, my eyes were rolling back, and then the two ladies that work for St. John's, shout out St. John's, man, big help.
Yeah.
They came across and they were in a panic when they saw my eyes roll back.
Mm.
So the suburbs boys carried me to the ambulance, and then literally like 5 minutes down the road, we had to stop because I was pretty much out, like I was dead. Like, because there was no
pulse.
No oxygen supply to my brain. Like, that's what the doctors were saying.
Yeah.
So another paramedic, emergency car had to come, and then she resuscitated me.
Do you know where she had to come from? Like, was she nearby, or did she come
crazy
from?
She was on cover that shift, so she usually works out Rewa, Mani Rewa. Yeah. So I was just, man, I was, that whole time, that whole journey to the hospital, man, it was like everything fell in place, like in terms of timing.
Yeah.
I was too blessed there to have each people in that, on that route I was to the hospital.
So what happened when they got you? When they had to get another paramedic? What did she do? What was going on?
Oh, I'm not too sure. So my mum and my girlfriend were following the ambulance and me. And then when we made the stop, Chujon was there as well.
Yeah.
And he couldn't help himself, but he started crying. It was pretty tough to see, for them anyway.
Yeah.
I'm not too sure what she... Oh, they intubated me. Yeah. So they had to put a tube down my throat so I could breathe.
Yeah.
And then they put the bag on me, and then, they got me to hospital. But I was still out. But I think I had a good pulse or something like that. I was breathing all right.
So what was... So you got to hospital. Then what was the process from... from that time you got to hospital, did you go straight into surgery or?
Yeah, so it got hectic from there because the game had finished, 4:30, 4:45?
Mm. Yeah.
And then got to the hospital around 7. So I didn't go into surgery until like 10. So there's still obviously a big gap because I had to wait for OR and for surgeon availability and stuff like that. So,
damn.
I mean, like for me, there's no trauma really because I was knocked out.
You didn't really understand what's going on.
Yeah, like. For my parents and my family and my loved ones, like, they were all going through it.
Yeah.
So they, like, word travels fast, you know, Auckland and families. So that time in between when I first got there and then when I went under the knife, like, my parents were, like, trying to stay as calm as they could, but they were freaking out.
Mm. Don't blame them.
Eh? Yeah, and then the surgeon came out or someone, and he said, so they had to cut out a bone flap, so I'm still missing a bone flap.
Shit.
So firstly they had to make a few decisions around if we wanted to keep it or burn it.
Yeah.
We decided to keep it, and then they said, oh, there's no point staying here, he's going under the knife now. If we call you, it's bad news. If we don't, it's good. So my parents were like, everyone went home.
Yeah.
And they were up all night. And I remember asking around because I wanted to know what happened.
Mm.
Like, just the timing. Everyone came flooding in, Saturday, family, friends.
Mm.
And they were just, no one wanted to leave, but can't really do much apart from wait, so you might as well go home. And then, that was Saturday night.
Oh, that's kind of one of the only times you probably don't want a phone call, eh?
Oh, exactly, bro.
It was quite a thing because obviously the week before you was this guy. And then I had got a message saying, did I hear about you?
Mm.
From a friend, and I said, oh, what happened? And they said, oh, the same thing that happened to Brody. And I was like, are you sure? So I messaged Auntie Tina.
Yeah.
I messaged her straight away and I said, Auntie, is Adrian all good? What happened? just expecting to be like, hey, what are you talking about? Well, she messaged back, oh, he had a head knock in his game and he's in hospital. And I was like, oh. And then, because obviously I know your family, like seeing your both of your sisters' posts, obviously you're close with Lani and that as well. We went over to Lani and that house on Sunday and but she was just in tears. And then I was just like, you're right, everything all good. But then my wife ended up talking to her and stuff. So I can only imagine like what it was like for everyone, especially your family, especially your parents.
Yeah.
Whether or not, you know, like they're not too sure of what's happening and all they can do is, I guess, just pray and wait.
Yeah, exactly that.
Man. So they would have went through a little bit of a waiting period, not wanting a phone call. Because like you said, if they get a phone call, it's bad news. Like probably the one time you don't ever want a phone call. So what are you going to do?
Do you just want to tell everyone like what you had, like what they diagnosed you with, like simply like your brain bleed and stuff like that?
Yeah, so I had a subdural hematoma. Sounds good, eh? But I wasn't. Yeah. So yeah, just the brain bleed in a part in some area of the brain. I'm not too sure what it was. It was due to an acute brain injury. So they think there was it was because of that specific rock.
Yeah,
but. Well, be honest, I've had a few head knocks, which I didn't really check, like in my time playing rugby.
Yeah.
And I think that's why I had, like, that happened. Mm. Yeah. Just had too many head knocks, but I didn't get it checked out. So that's probably on me as well.
I think we can all attest to having head knocks before and just carrying on playing, you know what I mean? I don't think we ever took head knocks as serious as we should until, you know, the incident between... used to, and obviously Tere and one of the other boys from your club, so I think, you know, like us talking about it now, we look back in hindsight, it's easy to, like, bro, we should have got this done, and this done.
Doubt,
but how long ago was the last head knock that you had before you kept playing, you know what I mean? Did you want to tell us, like, the effects and everything that it's had on like, yourself at the moment and, like, your everyday life?
Mm. Yep, so... when I got out of surgery, they said a few things. So I had a 6-month stand down period for driving. So I can't drive for 6 months.
Mm-hmm.
No alcohol for 2 years. Yeah.
Dang.
Easy work. I'm still living. So
that's
a small sacrifice I'm willing to pay.
Yeah.
So obviously still working on my left foot. Cause I pretty much lost feeling of it. Lost movement. So just rehabbing that. I think not driving is the biggest one. It gets kind of tedious at home sometimes when everyone's out the house at work. And obviously my two sisters aren't at home as well. So it gets a bit, I wouldn't say lonely, but boring sometimes.
Yeah.
I'd say that's the biggest thing about being at home, not driving.
Yeah. It's like me. They gave me a year. So I'm not allowed to drive for a year because I had the seizure.
Yeah.
So if you have a seizure, you're not allowed to drive for a year in case you have reoccurring seizures. So that, but I still drive. So.
Me and my dad are like a bit cheeky about it, but my mom shuts us down straight away.
So yeah.
Yeah. Better listen to the bus.
Tell us about the time we woke up from obviously surgery and that morning you woke up. Just tell us what you remember, who was around you, and just sort of give us something about waking up.
Yeah, so it's crack up, funny story. So I just got back from Oz the week before, and when I woke up on Sunday, so I was like drugged out on sedation and stuff. I thought I was, I flew on a secret plane back to Australia and I was in the hospital there because I saw my sister on Sunday.
Yeah.
I thought I was in Oz. She I was like, over. How the heck did I get here?
Yeah.
And then, so I woke up Sunday and then I heard how many people were at the hospital.
Yeah.
I heard there were like probably over 100 people at the hospital for me. And I was just like, and then knowing me, like I love people, like I love company. So I got knocked out because I was like trying to shake people's hands when they come in. And, like, just say hi and...
Just trying to do too much?
Yeah, I was doing too much. It was, like, overstimulation to my brain. So, I had to... My parents had to call it, so everyone just hung out in the whānau room and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I remember seeing a post from your sisters about... Oh, and your family, like, that you're doing too much.
Yeah.
And trying to stop people from coming up. Mm. Obviously, because like you said, you were like you love company and you love people around that you wanted to see everyone, but it was taking a toll on you.
Yeah.
So I remember seeing a post about it, and I remember because we were talking to Lani about coming up, and once we seen the post, we're like, oh, we better not go.
Yeah.
But it's good to see that obviously you've come out the other side. Mm. Obviously, you still got a long journey to go. But like you said earlier, like you're here and you're alive.
Yeah.
That's the main thing. Mm. That obviously all the blessings that happened, like you said, along the way, and people being in certain places for you to get to the hospital, for you to come out of surgery and be sitting here being able to tell your story, like that's a blessing in itself. So yeah, man, it's honestly good to have you here, and we hope that you have nothing but the best of your recovery, and we know that there's a long process. Obviously, this is what the opportunity for us is, to create a space for people to obviously offload a burden, or offload or even tell their story about, you know, what they're going through at the time. So yeah.
What's the rehab process like, the recovery process for you over the next, say, 6 months or to a year?
Yeah, so they said recovery time about 6 months.
Yeah.
The doctor said I was going to be in hospital till Christmas.
True.
So that's what my parents were, everyone was expecting me to be like in that state for a while.
Yeah.
But then, so I only spent 2 weeks in hospital.
Yeah.
Oh, 3 weeks, 2 weeks going on to three.
Damn.
Yes, and then I came home. I was blessed day.
Were you ready to come home? Or did you not mind being in there?
I felt I was ready at the time to come home. Like, there was no more need for me to be at the hospital because I was ready to start my rehab.
Yeah.
So I was supposed to be treated as an outpatient so I could get, like, physio at home.
Yeah.
But I spent a week at home and no one came. So I had to go to the rehab facility in Rānui.
What do you mean no one came?
Oh, so they, someone didn't organise the referral for the community team to come to my house? So it just got, man, the hospital was backed up. Eh?
Like, yeah.
I didn't really mind. And then I ended up going into the rehab facility, which was, it was mean, eh?
Mm.
Yeah, blessed for those guys because they helped me a lot.
Are you still going there now or your time?
Nah, so I rehab once a week out at Lincoln Road.
Yeah.
Yeah, got a physio there I work with. We just have weekly sessions.
Shit.
That's pretty mean. And then I try to, I just started running.
Oh, yeah?
So, yeah, it's not full proper, but I'm happy I can run. And then I have a group of boys that I train with sometimes. I don't know if you've seen it. Shout out Be Better Run Club.
Yeah.
Oh, we walk as well.
Work. Are you working or are you off work for, like, you know, a long period of time?
So, yeah, I was doing warehousing before, but obviously can't do that. I'm a part of a trust. Shout out Te Raranga Charitable Trust.
Yeah.
So just do some work for them. We have a program called Kumete under them.
Oh, yeah?
You guys have probably heard it. It's around mental health. So that's what my job. I work under that program.
How has things been for you mentally since, obviously, going through everything?
Man, that's it. Like, people ask me twice because they don't believe that I'm doing well.
Mm.
Like, the amount of gratitude outweighs any kind of negative feeling or what-if situation that I went through or that I will be going through. Like, just too blessed, man. Like I said before, like, the journey from when I got injured to the hospital, like, there's God's work, you know, like, putting people in each position.
Yeah.
Mm. Like, just despite what happened, it was a perfect, like, everything fell into perfect place.
Mm.
Yeah. So that's all I can say. Like, I do get itchy feet, like, I miss footy.
Yeah.
But, like, there's more to life than footy.
Yeah.
Mm. And it wasn't, like, I didn't place my identity on rugby. Like, it wasn't, like, what without major? Rugby, like, I don't know who I am. Like, that wasn't me.
Yeah.
Like, I'm in Christ, so, like, rugby was a part of me, but it's not all of me.
Yeah.
Mm. And I was just happy that I realised that. Early and fast.
So you'll never be able to play rugby again, right?
Nah, never.
Damn.
I can do drills and run with the team, but no contact or.
How's that? How did you take that? Like, when you first found that out, like, mentally, was that sort of tough on you, or did you sort of accept it? sort of straight away and just be like, okay, that's...
Yeah, as soon as I woke up and like I saw the bandaging, I was like, oh, this ain't good. I was like, bro, all the tubes and stuff, I was like, nah, I can't go back to rugby after this. And it's not like I was cracking it, you know. It wasn't like I was playing international. Like that would be a different story because you're obviously getting money out of it. But I think I just played rugby purely out of community. Yep. Like love being around the boys, the culture that it brought forth. So when I accepted it pretty early. Like when I was told, they were like, you can, but it'll, like if you get another knock, it'll affect that part of your brain again. So I was like, nah. After seeing what my family went through, I'm not putting them through that again.
Yeah,
that's something massive, especially for someone your age, like young like yourself. Like, because a lot of people, obviously, especially us Pacific Islanders and Maldives, like we love our sport. For you to make that decision early and be content with it, like you know what I mean? It's it goes to show the maturity that you have. Obviously, like it shows like probably the support that you have, because like you said, you didn't want to put your family through what they just went through. A lot of people would have. Me myself, maybe I probably would have. Well, when I broke my neck, I went straight back into it. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
But it's pretty cool to hear that you know, like you accepted it, you moved on, and again, you're going through the processes of things now. So, how was your guys' thing that you're going through with Kumiti and all that? Like, what's you want to tell us a little bit about that?
Not too sure how it'll go now that National got in, but
that's right.
Yeah, fucking right.
Public services, but nah, it's all good. Work with what we got.
Tell us a little bit about it, like what it is and all
yeah,
that
so
stuff.
Under the trust, we have three programs. So we got outsole, we got kumete, obviously. Oh, so outsole is around shoes and sneaker drives for the less fortunate. So we donate whatever we're given to kids with in low decile schools and to help out families. And so it's crazy times out here, you know. So
yeah.
Like the point for kumete, for the trust is to serve and give back to the community. So that's what we try to do. And obviously, we have kumete around mental health. So we have programs where we hold workshops at our workshop in Onehunga.
Oh yeah.
And then we recently just held one at Auckland Uni. So that was pretty mean.
Yeah.
It was like it's good practice for us moving into like corporate spaces or businesses, like bigger companies.
Yeah.
So that's pretty mean. And then our third program is Link Up. So it's financial literacy.
Yeah.
So just helping people pathways into work. It's all just jump starting, but hopefully we can get it off the ground, up and running.
Damn, that's something that our people lack massively. Yeah. Financial literacy.
Yeah,
I guess like I got a nephew, Arda's son. He goes to St. Kent's.
Yeah.
That's a subject there. I think now in schools they're starting to become subjects, but I know when I was at school,
nothing.
You say financial literacy, they'd be like, "What's that? What the hell?"
Yeah,
don't even say financial.
Yeah, and that's something that our people have struggled with for years and generations. Like, so for you to do what you're doing, that's awesome, man. Mm. How many of you are involved in the trust and all the programs?
So there's six of us.
Yeah.
Yeah, real small.
Do you want to shout them out? Or?
Yeah, shout out Christian, Carmelita, Lemeki, Sam, and Nate.
Yeah.
That's our team there.
That sounds good. What else are we going to? You got me lost after listening to some of that stuff. This, some of the spaces that I guess, like me and you, always talk about, especially men's mental health. We know that's a big one. How's your family doing since the injury? Obviously, you said you're feeling a bit lonely. Like, is that because of now you've got to rely on people to take you places? Obviously, you can't drive. And like, how's things at home going for you?
Yeah, things at home. Like I'm big on family, yeah. So big on like company and just family quality time.
Mm-hmm.
But because my older sister lives in Oz, and then Ton's my little one lives in Wellington.
Yeah.
So after it all happened, everyone kind of had to go back home and resume their lives.
Yeah.
But my family was already close, but it brought us much closer.
Yeah.
Mm. Just having that time together, and I really kept them on their toes.
Oh yeah. That's cool to see, because funny, because a message today that we had was like through any tragedy or any like adversity, like God reveals himself.
Mm.
And I guess you would have seen him reveal himself and to you and your family during that time. So probably pretty cool, man.
Who's been like, say like big influences on you like during this whole recovery time, and like just some people who have, you know, helped you along, you know, this whole recovery thing? Like, who's some big people that have helped you so far?
man, I had a lot of prayer warriors. My girlfriend's church, obviously, my church praying over me. A lot of family and friends praying over me, visiting. It was just, it was crazy. Like, everyone says it was me, but, like, I couldn't have done it alone. It was the prayers and my family and friends that got me through it. During my stay, I spent 3 weeks at the rehab facility out Rānui, and my best mate, Buster, you know, Buster. Shout out, Bus. man, there for me every day. Always came to the rehab. Like, lived around the corner, so it was perfect.
That's his neighborhood.
Yeah, 135. Shout out, Rānui. So he was there every day. So we would have our podcast sessions, yeah. You know, just like from, he would come after work. So like 6 to 10 would just be 4 hours of us chatting and catching up. So he was a big part of my journey. And then also, yeah, my parents and my girlfriend and my siblings.
Damn, but like for me, like obviously my family were big, like my mum and my siblings, like especially those first few weeks, because I feel like those first few weeks are your toughest.
Yeah.
Just trying to get used to everything physically and mentally. And like I can feel what you say with your family. Like my mum was a big support for me as well as my siblings. And it's sort of like, I don't know, like when they're like, you don't realize how much they're doing for you, like during those times, because you're sort of just like, you have to rest and sit back, but yet they're always on the move. Like, yeah, what do you want? Are you in need of, you know, what do you need? What do you want? Do you want to go somewhere? And I feel like, bro, like our families do, especially during those times, like it's important to have good people around you, as well as friends and family. So it's cool to hear, like, you know, you had your boys around you too, like you say, your mate Buster, it was like this guy for me, you know, always there, always talking, making sure you're all right. And you sort of need it too, because you're always so bored and stuff like that, eh? It was like when I was in hospital, this guy was coming every day, and I was only just allowed out the room. I wasn't allowed to like go anywhere past the room.
Yeah.
This guy was taking me across the road to the cafe, like stuff like that. Come back, where'd you go? Oh, went down the road. Getting in trouble, but that's cool, man. Like,
What's next for you? For like now, like moving forward, like what are you looking at? Like, what's your plans in regards to, obviously, no more rugby? So what's your plans in regards to life? Obviously, you still got your rehab that you do and the programs that you guys run. What's next for you?
Yeah, so obviously priority right now is just to get my body right, my foot right. And you got to wait for surgery. My second surgery.
What?
You got to go for another one?
Yeah, so I got to put my bone flap back in.
Oh.
Yeah.
Can I just quickly ask you, you know how they asked you, do you want to keep it or burn it?
Yeah.
What does that mean?
So a protective layer of my brain, they had to cut open to get to my brain, obviously.
Yeah.
But we can keep that part of my head. Oh. Yeah, so they cut it off, and then a layer under my outer, they took. So they had to ask us if we want to keep it or burn it, because we can use it again.
Mm.
Oh, okay. We can use that bone flap again. Oh. So I've got the option of using that bone flap or getting a 3D printed one made from Australia and sent over here. But there's a few downsides to both.
What are the downsides?
So downside, again, if I get my bone flap put in, it could, over time, disappear. Like, it could dissolve, because
I know what you're talking about.
Blood.
What happened to my neck?
Yeah.
Or put a bone in and it disappeared.
But if we go, brain absorption, something like that. And then if we go with a 3D printed one, I could have. So 30% of people have complications with that surgery. Shit. So, bro, the surgeon was like bluntly nice with me, eh?
Yeah.
Like, he just telling me straight, I was like, sweet. But the heart was beating a bit, eh? All right. And then he said I could have seizures, another brain bleed.
Yeah,
because of the pressure, and then I think those were the main ones that stood out. But the heart was going da-dum, da-dum, da-dum. Man, it was a interesting phone call, but just trying to pray about it and not worry about it, because I can't really control it. at the moment. So, yeah.
So you're having a surgery, and what are you doing? Are you getting the bone flap put back on, or are you getting a 3D one, or what?
Oh, I'm not too sure. Because if there's infections, like they say, bugs, bacteria, if it gets onto the one at the hospital, then I have no choice but to go for the 3D printed one, yeah.
Mm. What do you prefer? What are you leaning towards?
I'm still not sure. It's a decision I haven't really
finalized.
Finalized.
Yeah. When is your surgery?
So I asked them, it's about a 2-month ballpark. Oh, so it's cutting it close because my older sister gets married in Thailand in Feb next year.
Yeah.
So hopefully I can have it in Jan, the latest, just to give some time. Because the recovery times are not that long.
Yeah.
But it's the side effects.
Yeah.
That if anything happens, I've got to get back under the knife. So is it worth traveling?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to go under the knife in Thailand. 100 baht.
Might come back with a big chest.
Tattooed up. What's the, for me, I've had a lot of boys reach out after, they've had head concussions and stuff like that. Has it been the same for you, a lot of boys reaching out to you, saying, because I've had boys go, what were some of your symptoms? Because I've got a head knock and this is what's happened to me. Have you had the same?
Not too many have had, severe injuries
But
I've had boys with injuries check in and just how are you doing? But it was funny, I was at Zookeepers in Royal Oak one time, and the security, he pulled me aside and asked me what happened to my head, and I told him, and he had the exact same thing.
Sure.
Right, I was just buzzing out, he's doing well now.
Yeah.
Yeah, but not too many people reach out because of severity of their injuries, but the boys do reach out, just check in, especially the ones that have had bad head knocks.
Mm.
Yeah.
If we go back to rugby, obviously head knocks, how do we say it? We play a contact sport, right?
Yeah.
So, taking us off after a head knock is, but you got to drag us off.
Yeah, hard.
Unless it's, you're fully, unless, can't walk or whatever.
Yeah.
Or, like...
Unless you're me.
Yeah.
Or birds.
Yeah, or birds, us. You know what I mean? Us. So, what's some things that you would say might need a change in regards to us as men? What's some things that you would suggest that we... should do in regards to if we do get a head knock?
I think it's just a pride thing.
Yeah.
Just swallow your pride and get off.
Yeah.
I guess we're always thinking about getting the win in the short term, short term space, but we're not thinking long term, especially those that, have kids, have families. You don't want to be, excuse me if this is offensive, but a vegetable later on, You want to be there for your kids, there for life.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, I'd say just it's a pride thing as well, but also the coaches, just get them off.
Yeah,
Safety comes first, I guess.
Mm.
Especially the game now, before you tackle to be dominant, now you tackle to hurt.
Yeah.
Mm. You know? Especially the game, the speed of the game is faster too. So.
Yeah. I said that in I did an interview a few weeks back, and they go, why do players not come off and stuff like that? And I said it's a pride thing.
Mm.
For us, we work all week. We train 2 times a week. Come Saturday, that's our fun.
Yeah.
This is, where we love to express ourselves, have fun. We play 5-10 minutes and you're trying to tell us to get off because you think, oh, we've got a head knock. No, no way.
Yeah, it's hard.
Because this is our time. This is our fun place. And... But I think, what you said, it is a pride thing for us, where I think now, with all the rules that are all coming in with head knocks and stuff like that, it's going to become a lot harder because, like we said, no one wants to come off the field. Mm. And I think, with the league especially now, it's going to be a lot more stricter.
Yeah.
So... Get off the field, man. Get off the field.
Well, here, let me ask both of you this question. Would you put it down to, obviously, you used to both been in, had serious head knocks, but if it was to happen to someone now, a head knock, and you knew that they got concussed, would you be forcing them off as a teammate or, as a friend? Or would you be he said he's all good, let him carry on type of thing? Because... that's what happened with me and this guy. Remember, Man Albert got knocked out. I got knocked out in a game. Don't remember the second half, but boys had asked me, are you good? I said, I'm all good.
Mm.
Acted like nothing happened. Carried on playing. Not, like, touch wood, nothing ever happened. But now that we see the severity of the injuries, like, you're lucky. You're lucky. There's other people that haven't been so lucky. What's your thoughts now on if it was to happen to someone as a teammate or on the sideline or as a coach? Like, do you think people need to be more firm and more strict on it?
Yeah.
That are part of the team, because obviously not the competition, but team.
Mm.
What's your thoughts?
Bro, I'll be big on it, forcing them off the field, especially after going through that. Bro, I've gotten, like, yeah, so more, like, much more emotional around that kind of stuff.
Mm.
Like, just seeing anyone hurt just takes me back to the day I got injured.
Yeah.
Like, not too overwhelming, but always takes me back. Yeah. And it just humbles me because I'm like, man, that's selfish of me to let them go through what I went through.
Yeah.
Like, God forbid they go through what I went through, but even a head knock, like feeling groggy throughout the week, that's not a nice feeling.
Yeah.
Mm. So just if you can, like, prevention, I'll be big on prevention now, like, that I've been through that.
Yeah.
Like, I wouldn't want any other brothers, like, going to war and then, like, you don't even get paid. Well, league does, but rugby, we don't, you know? So
we don't.
We don't.
Oh.
Chump change.
So we don't, yeah, like, you're playing for free, but you're playing for the club community, so, like, it's kind of, you got to weigh it up.
Mm.
But, yeah, I'll be big on it now,
yep,
after what happened.
Mm. Yeah, I'm the same as you. I'm big on it now. Even when boys ask me, like, I've got a head knock, I'm like, bro, don't risk it. Mm. There's a bigger picture. Like, this, you always say to me, there's a bigger picture. Mm. There's life outside of rugby league, sports isn't everything. But, nah, yeah, like what you said, Age, prevention, definitely. You don't want anyone else to go through what, I guess, we experienced, and
fair enough. Yeah, that's I think that's going to be taken a lot serious, especially with yourself in the league scene and yourself in the rugby scene, and I hope that we as players, teammates, coaching staff, to chairmen or people part of a club, that we start taking head knock seriously. I can't talk, but again, like I was saying, like, now that I've seen, like, this guy is so fortunate that you've been through your experience, and that obviously someone else has been through the same experience as well, but didn't get the same, like, obviously passed away. Mm. So it puts everything into perspective when I look at both of you, because, look, you're obviously not allowed to play rugby anymore. You're allowed to play rugby. You still got a surgery to go through. Like, you're all good. Like, you know, you're just waiting for a clearance. Mm. But there's other people, like you said, that are not so fortunate. Mm. So when I always say, like, look at the big picture, is like, man, like, just look at what's ahead. Obviously, like you said, we're not professionals. We play it for the fellowship, the love of the sport. We play it just to hang out with family or friends. So, like, just remember, like, it's not in a professional scene. So it's just like a hobby type of thing. And if it's going to affect people on the outside of your circle and everyone else, then, you know, really have a think about, is it really worth going back out there?
Yeah.
Because, like we said, it's always an ego thing, eh?
Yeah.
And you're never taking me off the field unless I'm on a stretcher, that type of mentality.
Yeah. And you end up on a stretcher. Yeah.
This guy didn't want to go up on a stretcher. What did you do? You walked off, or you got carried off?
Carried off.
Because talking to Lani, I remember Lani thought that you'd done your knee.
Yeah. See, that's what everyone thought. They thought I did my leg.
Oh.
Yeah.
Bro, I was like, I woke up. I didn't wake up. Oh, like, I come to. Now, like, gotta work for the stretcher. I was like, don't bring that fucking stretcher on this field. I ain't fucking going off on a stretcher.
And I then what happened?
I went off on a stretcher.
they brought the stretcher on. He told them, fuck off, take the stretcher away. Whoever took it back must have put it somewhere and hit it.
Yeah.
But then they said, bring the stretcher on because we need to get him off the field. Whoever went to go look for the stretcher again didn't know where the stretcher was. So it took a little bit of time.
Shucks, man.
To get him off the field. Anyways, how do you keep yourself well mentally? Obviously, you said you got a few things going on, but, like, for people out there that obviously don't have those opportunities, what's some things that you do to keep yourself well mentally?
So fellowship's a big one. Like I said before, I meet up with some of the boys weekly and we just go for a walk. Try get it in the morning around the boys. So I go with Iz as well. Yeah, shout out Iz.
Yes.
Sanga. Yeah, we try to go for walks, like sunrise, sunsets.
Yep.
Just to spend time and just chat. Like, life's getting busier for everyone, so it's a nice time to just, I guess, reflect and just see how everyone else is doing, not just the up to you, how you've been, you know. Proper catch-ups during the week.
People underestimate that, eh?
Yeah.
Like, that's why we, like, especially with Robbie, especially during the lockdown, like, we started a thing where we would train in the morning and then hang out at a cafe after. Obviously, lockdown, there was no cafes we used to walk to. I think it was the Hollywood Bakery. But people underestimate, especially men, underestimate just the training in the morning and then hanging out with your close people before starting the day.
Is that brotherhood?
Yeah, we're doing that brotherhood. Yeah, we started that with the, that's what, like, that was our, like, routine. And then, like, we carry that on now. Like, we come to, obviously, the gym here at Bosford, and we go down to the bakery, and it's so underestimated, but I think we as men sort of take it for granted as well.
Yeah, hard.
Because we know just how important it is to be around, like you said, like, your little circle of boys, like, how it affects you mentally. It obviously uplifts you and gives you that type of thing. What's your thoughts on, like, that little routine that we got going on, and, like, how these boys...
Yeah, it's a good way to start the day, I think. Like, it saves, you know, your typical wake up, get ready to go to work. Whereas I think if you wake up, you have something to look forward to. You go gym, see the boys, catch up, go for a coffee. And that way, I think, like, your mind's clear as well. Yeah. Before you start your day, you're happy. You know, you just caught up with the boys. So I think... it's like, for me, it's much needed. And I know for yourself, it's needed too. Because every time I don't wake up early for the gym, you feel like shit, we're working, working all day.
Your day's so gone.
Fucking.
Start off on shit. A bad note.
So, that sounds cool what you do. And who knows, mate, maybe one day we can have to link up and come for a walk with
it's
you
open,
fellas.
Mate. It's open, mate. It's open to anybody.
Yeah. So, where do you see yourself in the next 5 years?
Always wondered how to answer this question. Hopefully marriage is on the cards in the next 5 years.
Nice, brother. Have you got on the knee? No.
Nah.
Wait, I'll dust it off.
Not that.
Oh, the other side.
Other knee. just look for a solid work, a solid job that, you know, like, has good opportunities. Still on the, I'm blessed that I have time now to do that, sort it out. Just hopefully have a family by then, and still be helping out in the rugby community.
When you say you wanted to find, like, a job, explain to us what your ideal job is. You want to use your degree, or do you want to get into, like, the men's mental well-being space, or, like, what would be an ideal job for you?
I wanted to carry on with psychology. I was always interested in behavior, what makes people tick, and why people do the things they do. But that obviously got put on hold. So it was always that and counselling. Always just because love a chat, love a yarn. So why not get paid for it? And help people as well in the process of things. So those are always my goals in terms of a career growing up. I knew that from early on. But after everything happened, I just want to step back from studying and just work and save up. Getting expensive out here, man.
Oh, you're not. How's your new outlook on life? Like, what's, like, you know how you lived life before, obviously, your injury?
Yeah.
Has it changed since your injury? Or, like, not in regards to, like, your injury and whatnot, but, like, just the way that you look at life? Because I know a few people that used to live life just looking forward to the future, but then they got told, oh, you only got X amount of months left in your life. And then they totally flipped their life around and they live day to day, for the now and then. Like, how's the injury? Has the injury affected your outlook on life, or actually, what is your outlook in life, and has it affected you with that injury?
Bro, knowing going through what I went through and knowing what I do now, bro, I would have tried heaps of other stuff. You know, not just rugby, but just going out there and trying new things. I'd say, because now that rugby's taken away from me, I do have opportunities to look at other stuff, other sports. Like, me and one of the boys were just teeing up, planning to do a triathlon one day. You know, just try something new. Golf. He saw the boys go golf. Willie T loves his golf.
Guy at golf, but still
goes. You know, so, like, doing that on the Saturday morning, and then my day's freed up to go watch the boys. Because, like, when I see boys playing rugby, like, doesn't hinder or, like, affect me.
Yeah.
I get itchy feet and that's about it.
Mm.
But I still love to get involved, you know. So
yeah.
My outlook on life is try new things, don't be afraid to do it, and just enjoy life while you have it, because it can be taken away just like that.
100%.
And almost 100%. Almost did. So yeah. Just grateful, man.
Damn. Actually, what did he tell us to ask him at Shisha? Was it about a story with Chujo? Or was it Wakey? Did you have a boxing match? Tell us a little story about that.
Who told you this?
Shout out to Ramo from Jans for giving us the story. The owner of Jans told us the story.
Wait, a fight with who? Chujon.
Did you have a boxing match or something?
At my house, yeah.
Tell us what happened.
Nah, we were just back in the bender season. No longer in that season of life, but we were drinking at mine. And bro, this is like 3 o'clock. Chujon comes back pretty on a good buzz.
Yeah.
Right. Every time we drink, he always like throws a jab at me. He's like odds, bro. I've been on the receiving end and it's not nice. Anyway, Chujon was just throwing jabs. And I was like, bro, chuck on the gloves.
Yeah.
It was like, and then Kane, shout out Kane. Kane was egging it on. So we walked down to the bottom of my street. Bro, it was like 3 o'clock in the morning. Chuck the gloves on, and then I dropped them.
Yeah.
I got evidence too. Yeah. Shout out to
hey, no more throwing jabs anymore.
Yeah, can't throw that anymore.
It was actually Kane that told us.
Yeah, see, yeah, it was Kane.
Shout out to White Chocolate.
White Chocolate.
We were asking him, we were sitting at Shisha.
He came on Thursday.
On Thursday, and we were like, gee, what's some stories that we can ask AJ? He goes, gee, ask him about that time that him and Juju had a boxing match.
We're like, did he get dropped? And he goes, nah, he won. We're like, no, we need a funny story we can mock him about. He's like, I'll ask Wax.
Yeah.
Nah, they have a few dumb ones. Bro, I had a funny one of when I was in hospital though.
Let us know. Tell us.
Well, I don't know if it's funny, but I got surprised. So the orderly or the nurse that was on my shift,
yeah,
like I wasn't able to stand up in the shower, so I had to sit on the commode and shower. But he saw more, so he didn't really understand much English.
Yeah.
So he was like, he was washing me, right? And I thought he left because he just disappeared out of my sight.
Yeah.
And then I just feel the cloth go up where it shouldn't have. Burned. I jumped out of the seat, I jumped up, I was like, bro. And then I was like, oh yeah, sweet. I got up and just like rinsed myself off, bro. I don't know if I felt clean or why. Man.
Oh, bro, I'm so glad I could wash myself.
Like, bro, I could. But the man was like, because he was a nice, they were good nurses, bro.
Yeah.
Like, everyone was nice to me and good to me. But he was a bit too nice. I was like, Solly, get off me, man.
Save that for my missus, man.
And he had to be someone, too.
Bro, I was like, uncle.
Hey, you got a
bottle. that was probably a funny one. Like when I told the boys, yeah.
That's hilarious.
Glad you told us, because now I can get
open.
That's what
vulnerable, man. Vulnerable.
Got to take a man to be a man, eh?
Hard, man. Literally.
Do you know? Hey, we love everyone, eh? We love everyone. Nah. But yeah, again, man, I think for us, that's what we wanted to do, is create a platform for you. And I think that listening to your story and hearing obviously what you've gone through and where you are today, for me personally, it's a true blessing. Like you said, you went through blessing after blessing in regards to your journey to the hospital and to where you are now. And I think what you're doing with the trust and the program that you guys are running, I know that God's hand will be over you and all your crew of I wouldn't say boys, because there's a girl in it.
Yeah, Carmelita, the only female.
God's hand will be over your guys' programs, and I know that moving forward, that again, you'll be a good ambassador in regards to what you've gone through with your head knock, and obviously you're not just all for looks, because you do have a brain that actually is pretty smart, eh?
Yeah.
So for me personally, it's pretty cool to just to listen to your story and obviously relate. from outside point of view, obviously dealing with this guy. So thank you very much for your time, Us, and thank you very much for, again, giving us an insight and letting us hear it come straight from you as a person, what you truly went through and the support that you have for your family. And yeah, I can't thank you enough for giving up your time, and thank you enough for coming in and sharing with us about, obviously, such a major event that's going on in your life. And obviously, it's changed the course. But like we said, everything happens for a reason. And it's probably a course that you'll be able to affect more people going through what you went through. So just from me, Us, I just thank you very much for, again, your time and giving up your time and coming in and sharing with us and being able to share with people who are watching as well. So that's just from me.
I don't know. Yeah, pretty much what this guy said, G. Thank you for jumping on and sharing your story. It was actually pretty funny. I did a TV show interview a while ago, and I got to tell a bit of my story. And for me, like, I don't know you personally, or I just knew of you and sort of your journey and what you went through. But like, you're an inspiration to me. Like, without you knowing, like, I look at there's a guy, Tere, who had the same sort of incident, and I look at you two, and you two are what inspire me to live every day and just be grateful for what I have. I'm grateful where I get to be able to play rugby and live life, whereas I know you won't be able to play ever again, and Tere won't be able to, I guess, live life again. And bro, straight up, when I say you're a big inspiration to me, like, I really mean it from the bottom of my heart. And I felt it was really important to get you on to share your story. I've been given platforms to share mine through this and through a TV show, and I felt it was really important to for you to share yours. And that's why I told this guy, I said to message you and to see if we can get you on and see if this is something you'd want to do. But yeah, once again, thank you for sharing your story. I know it'll help a lot of boys. Mm-hmm. It'll help a lot of boys through realizing what concussion is and giving boys like us telling our story, but making it realize to people that there's more to sports and rugby than what there really is. You know, there's a bigger picture, and for us, I think we're I don't know how to say it, but like we're I can't figure out what to say, but yeah, thank you again for jumping on. Yeah, you're a big motivator for me, and I think you always will be. Because every time I feel like I'm going through a tough patch, I just think of you and the bro, and you know, I'm sweet again, because I just got to remember to be grateful for where I'm at and stuff like that. So thank you once again for jumping on. I'm sure a lot of people are gonna want to listen to your story, and yeah,
we'll leave you with the last words. We'll say you can finish it off the way you want to finish it off, and then. You know, again, we're grateful and thankful for your presence, and grateful and thankful for, again, your time.
So lastly, I just want to thank you boys for allowing me to jump on the space. I think what you guys are doing is mean. Just giving people like myself and people from all walks of life a chance to share their stories. I love a good yarn, so thank you for that. And just close off by just being grateful to God for what he's done for me and my journey, and for the amount of people in my life, or for the people in my life and the life that I have. Mm-hmm. I could have been way worse. There were people worse off than me, so gratitude is everything for me. Just grateful for what I have and the people in my life. So yeah, thank you again, boys. Appreciate it.
Thank you very much, Moses. Again, all the best with your journey, and we're looking forward to see what you and the boys, you and your crew have in the spaces that you guys are in.
Let's get ready to rumble!
Wasn't on that beat, hope.